spittle in the headphones.
It was 4:21.
Pauline, what was the first timing? Should be 2.
Peter, the first part of the set.
Do you want to do one more run of that?
The first part isn't as well.
Can we take it from Kieran's introduction?
The influence of television has changed the pattern of social life in the country quite a lot. There isn't as much playing of music by the fireside as there used to be because of television. But the radio programmes in the early years in the 50s, particularly the programmes by Kieran McMahona, helped tremendously in popularising traditional music and bringing it back to the people of the country. Did exist in isolated parts of the country, and there was a danger that the traditional music might die out, but it has made tremendous comeback in the last 20 years or so, and I think people like Kieran McMahon have been responsible in a great part for that.
Okay, so it's from the top again, and you can go on the red light. Sorry, hello? Yeah, we'll take it from the top again.
Another thing I like are the Ilian pipes. I even tried to learn them once by means of a do-it-yourself sort of operation. The result was predictably disastrous. But at least the experience left me with a healthy respect for the art of pipering. One piper who was generally heard far too seldom was Padder Brough, a Dublin man who went to live in County Cork and died at an early age only a few years ago. One of the very few examples of his playing left to us is this recording of his rendition of the lullaby Anon Sanal.
That's okay, isn't it? About 25 years ago, Radio Éireann, this is the radio station, we didn't have television that time, was able for the first time to go out to the country and record people and then broadcast this material so that people from one part of the country were hearing fiddle players and pipers and singers from other parts for the first time. And this created a great interest.
How many microphones?
I would say for 2 anyway, wouldn't it?
I'd say 3 would do. There might be a couple more coming on later,
yeah.
But at the moment it's only a few tin whistles and the Ilian pipes.
Well,
we'd make
a thing for 3 anyway.
Yeah.
We'll be dead safe enough, wouldn't we?
And there'll be a sort of an audience there, but I think they'll be quiet.
I know. So I said on Niagara on the EMT today. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Well, listen, I'd run in and... Fair enough, I'll see you inside. Okay.
So this is what it all, where it all started, with you in the radio, doing radio things.
Oh yes, indeed. That's my first love, and still my first love, going around collecting musicians and recording them for radio.
And you prefer that to studio work in TV?
Oh, I think so, yeah.
Why?
I like
why
to do about 80% radio and 20% television. It's much more relaxing, and in ways some of the material suits radio better than television.
You know, going on location and doing things on the spot.
Yeah, the atmosphere is much better in radio because you don't interfere as much with the atmosphere as you have to do with television. And if the weather is bad, that's so much the better because then people aren't working out in the fields or working. So the bad weather is better for music than the good weather.
Honey!
That's between you and me.
Did he object?
I'd say the likes of Ciarán, which we have a lot to attribute to, came around and tried to revive music, which he did, like my friend Junior here. Junior hadn't many occasions to go out and play music till the Sunday night pub life started, and they met and got together more than what they did in the past.
But still, people are watching television, and that is said to be a bad thing for musical life. Is that so?
It would be a very good thing if we had more traditional programs in television, which is a disgrace that we haven't.
Getting
I think it is, anyway.
Well, of course, in every country, television is quite a recent thing anyhow. And this problem has to do with all kinds of music, of taking it out of its natural environment and into a television studio. And this is a difficulty for all kinds of music, because it's not easy to present music in television.
I was there 3 or 4 times, and he didn't come straight to me, but he said for the first time he would be very nervous and shaky. You wouldn't play as good as you'd play sitting down at a proper group of dancers. Yes. You'd be watching yourself at fear of making a mistake, and it'll be like when you do it so many times, you'll get used to it.
Well, if you could do, and instead of doubling to do it.
We feel honoured, so does Joan, I'd say, to be invited to the studio, as I tell you that. Very much honoured and very grateful.
Okay, right. Okie doke, so we'll do that once more, Nash.
Right, 10 seconds again. 9.
Just me.
8, 7, 6, 5 seconds, 4, 3, 2.
Scale Brownach and Shane Ain shook the Deirdre Nivrian Bolayeri. Ach, couldn't we swing and Brown agus Neil Balacher be Nis Charlotte Shinny Yenna na Eistacht agus Brano Dansa Condemn Clord. The Monarch set dancers from County Clare. Some of this group have, of course, danced their way from Mullock and Quilty to Washington, D.C., and as far as the Cordon Fields of Iowa. It has been said about this sort of dancing that the men, the male chauvinists, take over all the fancy work, and that the ladies are only there as a sort of a attractive a group of charming persons. Well, Fagam we chewed Maratasha. Don't believe a word of it. Here's the Mullock set.
Studio is a problem, and it certainly has been a problem with Irish traditional music. It's difficult to find a formula to make this music as natural in the studio as it is in its own country or town and location.
I'm not happy going to studios, either radio or television, because I find the situation there far too formal. And it takes me out of my usual environment where I play. And we often find, where television is concerned, that our television producers, they don't quite understand the attitude of traditional musicians as they should do.
Mm-hmm. Do you think this is a problem?
I think it's a problem, and I think it's something that the producers will have to learn, rather than the traditional musician trying to adapt his music to suit television. I think it has to be the other way around. Because it's the music that's all important, not the producer.
Before the advent of radio and television, people were inclined to make their own entertainment at home or in the houses of their immediate neighbours. Now the tendency is to go and enjoy it on a commercialised basis, that they have to pay for their entertainment.
Don't forget now, Sean O'Dowd and Ding-a-ling at the West County Inns this weekend, dancing 9 to 1:30. So don't forget now, Sean O'Dowd on the bandstand there for your entertainment. Don't forget now, this weekend at Ennis, Sean O'Dowd and Ding-a-ling will be on the bandstand for your entertainment at Ennis.
One big change is that the youth now are prepared to travel up to 40 miles to go to a dance. This has led to the decline of the neighbourliness that existed in the country, especially, and even in this little village.
Do you think that traditional music is really afflicting the population of Ireland today? Or is it just sort of nostalgic feeling of romanticism?
Oh, I think that there's something in the Irish build-up, in every Irishman's heart. He reacts, you know, in a certain manner to the traditional music. It sets the feet tapping, you see. And even though he has sampled the jungle rhythms and Tin Pan Alley rhythms, I think he's inclined now to realise that it is like the man who sold his pig and bought bacon, you see. He got a bad bargain. He's going back to his own tradition again, I think.
There's been a tremendous revival of interest in folk music all over Ireland, which is part of the general folk revival all over the world, especially in the United States and England, Scotland, and more recently, I believe, in Norway and Sweden. And I think one of the reasons is that young people reacted against conventional music just after the war. And many of these young people went into pop music. But these same people stayed and started to take an interest in their own folk music. And this, I think, is one of the major changes. In the old days, if you were interested in traditional music, it was automatically assumed that you were against all modern music and jazz and so on. It was felt that these two things could not live together. But of course, young people have shown that this is not true at all.
I was interested in different music up to about till I was 15 or 16. I was listening to pop music and jazz and whatever. And then I gradually got more and more interested in traditional music. So I perform a different function in the band in that I suppose I put in elements that aren't directly traditional but that relate to it. You know?
Yeah, but you put the mark on the arrangements.
Accompaniment kind of thing, yeah.
He's been modest there.
But individually, I mean, some of you have a traditional training and come from a traditional milieu, sort of.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that is true.
Matt, for instance, yes.
Well, my father and two uncles played flute, and my grandfather played flute and concertina. My great-grandfather played flute. Yeah. That's my pedigree for traditional music. I had no musical training as such, just learning from my family.
You are now recording for your own company, is that right?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
What is the advantage of doing that?
Total control.
Yeah.
Thank you. You know, I was just listening to the guitar there, Donal, and I don't know if the sound's quite right for this piece.
Maybe not.
I think we could consider doing something with it there.
Yeah.
Just as it goes into that section.
Yeah. On this recording, we might duplicate things. Maybe instead of having one guitar, we'd have two guitars, but both doing the same thing, so that the sound that you get from your speakers is just enhanced, it's just made fuller.
But you're bringing other instruments as well, I mean, like the bouzouki.
Mm.
Why did you do that?
Well, it doesn't matter what instrument you play the music on, if you've got the right feel, if you've got the right approach, mentality to the music, you can play it on anything.
We like it.
You know, I mean, it's...
Play what you like.
The instrument is if the feel is there for the music,
yeah,
it's going to come out no matter what instrument is played.
Yeah.
But you do not use instruments you cannot use in concerts or live.
Well, we've used a few instruments on this album, which we don't have, but which we hope to get. You know, things like electric piano. It's like Vibes, you know, the electric piano. And it really suits that tune. I mean, the arrangement depends on how the tune sounds when it's unaccompanied, and then put it in around that, and maybe underline certain elements, like if it's a slow, quiet thing, to just sort of expand it, you know? But usually follow the mood, as closely as possible, and not change the original.
Have you ever considered doing live albums?
Well, I suppose one tends to be idealistic about the studio situation and get everything exactly as you want it. In a live concert, it's atmosphere, and the details aren't as important, you know? It's a whole sort of feeling, and usually it helps.
Mm-hmm. There's a tendency for, you know, to be a better charge of the music at a live concert.
Yeah.
You know, if things are going well.
Of course, you only hear a live concert once, whereas with a record, you know, you've got to hear it over and over again.
That's true.
So if there's anything which you think is just a little wrong the first time you hear it, and then you hear it over and over again, after 10 times, you feel you have to fix it.
Yeah.
Still a good live concert with everybody working well. The charge that you get from the music, I think, would carry. Three tunes there.
Probably, like a very good live concert is the best of all, I would think. You know, the good recording conditions and everybody in good form.
Otherwise known as Over the Water to Charlie, and the third tune was The Kid on the Mountain. And three tunes this time, in a different measure. There are three reels. The first is Music in the Glen, the second, The Humours of Scarlet, and the last one, Pull on Madhuishke.